Hugo Nogueira. Come on out.
Thank you. That was Milonga by Jorge, by Máximo Pujol, Argentinian composer. He wrote this piece specifically for guitar. It's part of a suite, Suite de la Plata. And I'm going to play now Verano Porteño by Astor Piazzolla, another Argentinian composer, very famous, probably the most famous composer from Argentina. But this piece wasn't written specifically for the guitar. This is a transcription, and a transcription is when a piece was written for a different type of instrumentation and you adapt to another instrument. So this piece and the following work are transcriptions. So the following work that is from a sonata from Domenico Scarlatti, is also a transcription, but was written for piano. And Verano Porteño, the piece by Piazzolla I'm going to play right now, was written for a few instruments, like bandoneon, which was the instrument Piazzolla used to play, that is similar to accordion, but a little bit different. Then guitar, and then violin, and a few other instruments. So this is an adaptation, a transcription for solo guitar. So Verano Porteño by Astor Piazzolla. Thank you. Thank you. So now I'll play an arrangement that I made on Over the Rainbow. And it's a short arrangement. I tried to use a few of the technical aspects of the guitar. And I think it shows that for people who are not familiar with the technique. So I think it's interesting. And then afterwards I'll play the... What's the name? Tango in Sky, by Roland Dienz, who was a Tunisian composer. Tunisian-French, it was like, I met him, he was like brilliant musician, I really liked his music and his character. I met him a few years ago, I think he died in 2016, and it's worth it to know his work if you're not familiar with it. And I'll play them Over the Rainbow and then Tango in the Sky by Roland Dienz.
Thank you.
So the second part of the recital is a chamber music, and by that I mean two instruments or more, in this case two, obviously. And we are playing only music written for piano and guitar. And the first composer we're going to play, I mean the first repertoire we're going to play was by Ferdinando Carulli, Italian composer from the early 19th century. He wrote a bunch of pieces for piano and guitar. And he used to play with his son, Gustavo Carulli. And those pieces are not very often played because back then they didn't have this guy here. They didn't have microphones. The guitar was way softer to different dimensions, different type of guitar. This type of guitar came the second half of the 19th century, built by a famous carpenter in the south of Spain, Antonio Torres. But before, we had the guitar much more limited regarding projection and the sonority in every aspect of it. So now we are kind of trying to bring back with our duo some of this repertoire that was lost in time. And the first piece is Allegro, duo in C major by Fernando Carulli, and will be followed by duo in E minor by Fernando Carulli as well. Sorry, I got a turn here, it's kind of...
Thank you. Thank you.
So now we will play a work quite different. It's by Radamés in Italy, Brazilian composer, more modern. So Radamés was born the last century, so I believe he died in the 80s. So his music is a little bit more complex and modern, needless to say. And he was an arranger and orchestrator in the radio in Brazil. So he wrote a lot of Brazilian music, arranged a lot of the Brazilian repertoire. And he wrote this work specifically for guitar and piano. It's a very intricate work. I think it's very, it's pretty amazing, I think. The harmonies and the rhythms, because, you know, Brazilian culture has such a rich rhythmic culture because of the African immigration. That was, I think, is the country that, if we can say, brought more people from Africa in the planet. I don't know if it's, that's the right word, but that's what happened. And so that you can hear in the music, which is very delightful, I would say. So here we're gonna play the first and second movement by Radamés in Italy. For is the second sonatina, and yeah, I hope you enjoy it. Thank you. Now we will play our last piece. It's one of my compositions, and I start to write for our duo because we don't have a lot of repertoire available, and the pieces I like, she doesn't like, and the pieces she likes, I don't like. So then we had to figure something out, so I start to write music for the duo. Since my bachelor's was in composition, I was like, maybe it's time to act. So then I start to write music, and this was the first composition I wrote for our duo. It's called Choro for the duo, Choro pro duo, in Portuguese, almost the same. And I started to write, and she didn't want to play, and then I had to really insist. And then she started to play, and she corrected a bunch of things, and then she said, "Can you write more?" I was like, "Well, I don't have time. Just write more." So anyway. So we'll play only one piece, but we have more pieces. You know, it's for our second CD. And like Dr. Gaga said, subscribe to YouTube channel of Pierce, but also subscribe to my YouTube channel if you can. You can find a lot of guitar music, a lot of repertoire for our duo. And it's always good to go to the right sources. So, you know, Pierce College, my channel, so you're not going to amateurs, you're going to where the real deal is. So with no more words, let's play Choro for the duo, and then we can open for questions if anyone has some questions for me, and we can talk about guitar learning process or teaching or whatever I can help with. So last piece, Choro for the duo. Thank you.
Any questions? I have a question for the audience, actually. So, is it proper when you have a movement that, when you have a piece that has multiple movements in a, at least a classical concert, to have clapping in between the movements? Should you clap or should you not? You should not. So whenever you have a piece in the program, and you all have a program in your hands, and you actually have multiple movements, in between those movements, it's proper etiquette for an audience member not to clap in between those. Why? Does anyone know why? Oh. Yes, because they're still in that piece, and technically they're transitioning from one movement to the other, so we want to keep their focus and their concentration on that specific piece of work, right? So that was just the thing that I wanted to throw out there for all of you. Yeah, and it's the same thing for instrumentalists and singers. So if I'm singing a song cycle, usually there shouldn't be any applause. But they were so kind to actually acknowledge you. But did they stand up from their seats and take a bow? No. Did you all notice that? Okay. So, sorry, I have to bring that up. Any questions? Yes, Christine.
I didn't hear the young lady's name.
Yes. We want to know who you are, you beautiful, gorgeous blonde.
Well, my name is Ekaterina Besmeltseva.
You got that?
Thank you.
We probably should have put her bio in the program, too.
Yeah, I told her. She said that we didn't need it.
Oh, yes. They're going to write all about you.
Yeah, they are more interested in her than I know. It's always the case.
Any other questions for Dr. Nogueira? Nogueira. Yes, Z.
There was a piece that reminded me of a French, like an Edith Piaf song or something, like a harmony. And maybe you said it was a French
composer.
Composer.
Yeah, Tunisian.
Tunisian.
The last solo piece I played.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah, well, he used to say he was from Tunisia originally, but he used to say he was French, you know, because he lived in France. He was teaching the conservatory in Paris. But most of his music is very influenced by French culture, French music, obviously. And that is just a tango, but I think you're right. I mean, if you compare that tango to an Argentinian tango, you see there is some different kind of aspects in that piece. So... yeah, that's all I can say, you know, because he was basically French. He was influenced by Chopin and other, you know, Chopin was Polish, but sort of French. He used to make a joke saying that Chopin was kind of French instead of Polish. He used to say that kind of thing. He was very proud of his French orientation, I guess, French culture.
Christine? Oh, sorry, go ahead.
One of the pieces that, or one of the movements, Bernardino, it sounded like very much like a waltz, and I wondered if it was used more for the elitist class or if it was something. What was the atmosphere for him?
Yeah, very good question. So, Carulli, he was from Naples in Italy, and he started to play cello and learn theory with priests. So there was not a very formal training that he couldn't find, at least in his town. And then he fell in love with the guitar, but he couldn't find a teacher. There was no guitar teacher back home. So then he started to learn by himself, although he knew music. He knew theory, he knew how to play the cello and all that. So then he wrote a method later on that is still used nowadays, and sometimes I use that with some of my students. So it's very interesting that he didn't have a teacher, a guitar teacher, and then he created one of the most prominent guitar methods, right? But he moved to Paris. He migrated to Paris, and he spent most of his life there. So he was playing for the elites in France, you know. And he played with his son, like I said, you know. But he played the most. He was a very successful guitarist in Paris, but he was always playing for the elites, you know. And I don't know if that answers your questions. But
well, that's where the money is.
That's where the money is.
I
we
guess.
Have one question right here. Yes. The second solo piece?
Yes. No, the Piazzolla. It's for which one? The Verano Porteño?
Yes.
No, that one is not for piano. Although some people play in the piano, the following piece is for piano.
In the beginning of that piece, you have some muting.
Yeah, piano. It's palm muting. Right. So it's an effect. I think it's to emulate when they call. When you do that with the double bass or cello, you know, with the fingers, not with the bow.
The pizzicato,
yeah,
with the plucking.
Yeah, pizzicato, exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we kind of try to do that. Mm-hmm. So that's one. It's because it's an arrangement. They are trying to emulate all the instruments with one, right?
Well, we're past 2:00. Thank you so much. If you have questions, I think Dr. Hugo will stay around to ask questions. You can just... But thank you so much for being here. And we actually don't have a concert until October 26th. Come back and watch me and hear me sing, okay? Thank you. Take care. Be safe.